What is up, Watch fam? I am Christian from Theo and Harris, and I am back here at London Jewelers Manhasset Watch Salon with my man.
What's going on, guys? My name is Anthony. I'm one of the managers here at the Watch Salon in Manhasset.
And today we're gonna take a look at two very different Tudors. You know, Tudor has a wide collection, and these watches almost have nothing in common, so I'm excited to dive into them.
Very different.
Let's do it. Okay, before we get into the Tudors, what are we wearing? What do you have in the rest?
Rolex Sub. This is a transitional model. This is 16800. So only made for 9 months, and it's my go-to.
I love
goes
that.
With everything.
I just noticed your wedding ring is rose.
Yeah,
that's
yeah,
very
yeah.
cool, dude.
Yeah,
you don't see that.
I need a rose gold Daytona now.
Yeah, I'm wearing an old Bulgari. It's like a lady's watch. It definitely was a man's watch
when
it
was made. That's a lady's watch.
Okay, so I think that the antithesis of the Bulgari that I'm wearing right now is that P01. So let's start there.
Sure.
Historically, we'll talk about the watch itself mostly, but historically, it's kind of a funny story and it's ambiguous. Rolex filed a patent officially in 1968, but the development was in the 1960s and throughout for a watch that would have a bezel that could actually lock in place, right? For, I guess, maximum accuracy, mitigating any sort of risk of, you know, change or right. you know, alteration. So, so what they came up with was this clamp at 12, it actually does lock the bezel position. Mm-hmm. So let's start playing with it.
I remember when this watch was first released, and it was polarizing. It was very yeah. different, especially from a brand like Tudor. And you know what? I think through social media, there was a lot of jokes going around about yep. it. And personally, I wasn't a fan until I started here almost 2 years ago. And when I had a chance to put it on the wrist, it is very, very, very cool. It's just a very different watch.
Which is funny, you mentioned that when the watch was released, people complained a lot, and that's true. The watch was met with a lot of kind of pushback. I also know a couple people that decided the day it was released that they were buying it, which is funny. Mm-hmm. But what's funny is every year when there's watch releases, you get, you know, the same two remarks, right? You get, oh, the same thing again. Oh, the same thing again. Oh, it's just a color change. And then when a brand tries something new,
right.
people love to, you know, kind of just complain. Now, I'm not saying you need to like everything that's released, but I do think that giving a watch a shot in the metal is it's extremely important. This watch is not for me. It's too big for my wrist, but I actually dig that Tudor released something that is not just different, but really is a tool watch. Mm-hmm. It's not a good-looking luxury watch that has tool background.
Right.
Right? Like, this is legit, like kind of like mil-spec.
Right,
like the
right.
function is, it was actually designed for that usage, very much like the mil subs. Mm-hmm. So I really appreciate that, you know?
I can see like a loyal, like a Panerai guy, like
yeah.
being drawn to this watch. I think, although my wrist is very small, I do like Panerai, and I like the oversized look of this. Obviously, I wouldn't be wearing this with a suit,
right.
but I think in more casual wear, I can appreciate how unique it really is.
Yeah, me too. I mean, listen, Tudor hasn't released anything like this since it came out, which I believe was a year or two ago, 2 years mm-hmm. maybe. Nothing like this has come out since, but I do hope to see Tudor kind of like after this in the next couple of years, release other mil-spec-ish watches. Mm-hmm. I love the Black Bay. Love it. But there's nothing not to love about it.
Right,
you know,
right.
I like that they have one model, maybe one spot in their collection that is different, maybe a little bit hateable to some. You know, I think, right, if you have no enemies, you don't really stand for much. You
right.
know, I mean, you know, it's the truth. So anyway, I'm a fan of the watch. I'm glad, you know, we're going hands-on with it. But
that's, I think that's what Tudor is. It's like, it's Rolex's, like, bad boy brother, where they yep. get to be a little bit more adventurous and
yep.
use different materials or different designs like this. So I'm excited what could possibly come out in the future, and I hope they go this route and do things a little bit more out of the box.
Well, even with gilt dials, right? Mm-hmm. Gilt dials were like the first thing that, you know, Tudor did kind of right out of the gate, mm-hmm. or objectively right out of the gate, that people have been begging from Rolex, and it probably won't happen, mm-hmm. right? But I love that gold print.
Right, you know? Right. That and a DLC sub.
Yep.
You know, these are things that people were doing on the aftermarket, and Tudor said, you know what,
we'll just create
it.
Yeah, Tudor was what, really reintroduced to the market in 2012-ish, 2013?
Yeah, right around there.
And it's just amazing to see how much they've grown. I mean, few brands have achieved what they have in such a short period of time. Like, you know, very few.
I really think for every brand, Tudor is one of those brands that they're competing with, because what they offer at this price point, it's really hard to compete with it.
It is. Yeah, I was thinking of another, the only other brand that I can think of that has grown so much in such a short period of time is Grand Seiko.
Right.
One of the only other brands. Mm-hmm. You guys carry Grand Seiko here.
We do. We do. I'd say it's another brand that offers a lot for the money.
Yeah, it does. I think that the commonality, apart from the growth, is, you know, you and I like watches, and because we're talking about hundreds of watches every week, it's good to have watches that you can actually talk about, something mm-hmm. that's interesting about them, you know?
Right. So yeah.
Anyway, okay, so this watch is you know, inherently more my speed, the size, the proportions, the case shape, I love the bevels. This is the Black Bay 41. Hold this watch, take off my watch, you could try it.
Super clean design. I really like the point buckle with the strap. They did a nice job with this watch.
Yeah, they really did. I love the big crown too. They also make this in 36. Mm-hmm. That's the size that I would get. But this 41 is really nice, you know?
It's wearable. And you know what? For someone that doesn't want a rotating bezel, this is the perfect option for it. Obviously, Tudor is kind of known for the Black Bay dive watch, but this is another great alternative if you don't want something too sporty. I think this becomes a very versatile watch.
Well, I think that, and I said this before, the Tudor collection, you know, while it's big, there are some gaps. And I think that historically, one of the biggest gaps since their reintroduction in the early, you know, 20-teens, was this, like, was a more, you know, formal, like, professional business kind of watch. The Black Bay is absolutely wearable with a suit, especially if you're changing your straps, but it's still a dive watch. Nothing wrong with that, but it's a dive watch. You're wearing a sub right now, and it looks great with a suit.
Right.
But it's different than, let's say, your Breitling Top Time. Right,
exactly.
You know, it just is.
Lastly, I would just add that for what you're getting, again, the price point, under $2,700, you're getting a really versatile watch that's really going to last time.
Do you see a lot of clients coming in for under $5,000, like professional watch? What's like the real...
Yeah, I think that's it's a very, very competitive price point, that under $5,000 mark. And being that we carry 30 brands, it's really endless what we can show them.
Yeah.
But Tudor is one of those brands that really people seem to gravitate to they offer a lot well under the $5,000 mark, this being one of them, almost half
that price.
Yeah,
it's not just under
point.
Five, it's well under five.
Right, right.
Yeah, that's fantastic. No, I'm glad to see the brand expanding, and I was looking downstairs, you guys actually have two showcases for Tudor.
We just expanded it.
I was gonna say, that wasn't the case. So your Tudor collection's pretty serious. I think next time we sit down, I wanna take a look at the chronograph. You know, like the Monte Carlo reissue.
Yeah, that's
Heritage
a great
Chrono.
Piece.
Really cool watch. Anyway, that's for next time. Ladies and gentlemen, Watch Geeks, thank you so much for watching. I enjoyed talking about Tudor, as I always have and definitely always will. Anthony, your turn.
Like always, guys, if you have any questions, you could always contact me by my email, which is anthony.kozlowski@lemonjewelers.com, or feel free to stop in. We have so many different salespeople that are willing to show you anything you want to try on, so please do stop in.
And there's usually some pretty sick stuff. There really is. You guys
absolutely
could come in if you're in the New York area. All right, adios.